We're going to start with our worship team. If you'll come on up, we'll get going.
Oh,
You may be seated. We've been lighting candles for Advent for the last, you can come right over, honey, light the candle. We started the last Sunday of November because Advent is 5 weeks long. We celebrate today the last candle, which is the center candle, the Jesus candle, because this is all about Jesus, anticipating his coming and his birth. And the Christ candle represents the light that the Son brought into the world. When he was born a little baby, God in the flesh. This was the very light of God come into the world. And in John it says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The fact that the Advent candles remain on Christmas Eve puts the focus on this special moment of birth, the moment of transition from prophecy to fulfillment. Let's bow our heads, shall we? Father God, it is with great joy that we meet here today. The anticipation of the celebration of the birth of Jesus. And Lord, as we ponder the story of that earth, it never gets old, and it's always exciting, and it's always special. Lord, we come today uplifting the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I pray that you will speak to our hearts today as we've gathered together to worship and praise you. Bless us. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. It's very good to be here with you today. And I was telling Pierre, it's very good to be above ground too.
Amen. So,
I know that some of you are wondering what in the world happened to me, and I'm going to do a quickie. I first went to the hospital last Saturday. I was working one of my jobs with a crew of about five guys, and I was supervising them. And I just passed out cold on the floor. And my son Jonathan called the paramedics, and I was taken to the hospital. And they really couldn't find what was wrong with me, but they said that your magnesium and potassium is very low. So they pumped me up with that, and I was feeling much better, so they sent me home. On Wednesday, Sandy and I were going to Chili's, and my walk from the car to the front door of Chili's was dizzy. I got inside and I began to become disoriented. So I sat down in our booth and I was trying to figure out what's going on. And I noticed that the room was going like this, and I was beginning to feel queasy and disoriented. I noticed I was forgetting some things. I forget where I was, what I'd ordered, And I thought, no, this seems to be serious. So I told Sandy, I said, honey, I don't want you to get upset, but I want you to take me to Loma Linda Medical Center emergency right now. Because it was only a mile away. And so I started scooting out of the booth and got on my legs and fell right on the floor. My legs wouldn't even hold me. And not only was that a surprise, it was embarrassing. But anyway, the waiters and waitresses know us well there, and they went and got a chair with wheels on it, and set me in that chair and wheeled me out to my car, lifted me up and put me in the car, and we went to emergency. And as soon as we got to emergency at Loma Linda, I passed out again. So, bottom line, after every test known to man, the bottom line was I had a TIA. A TIA is a precursor to a minor stroke. But the thing that helped me, besides God's grace, I'd already take blood thinners for my heart. And it dissolved the clot and just passed everything through. And once it was passed through, I felt great. And so they adjusted my medication. I came home Friday from the second thing in the hospital. Friday afternoon, and I was feeling pretty good. I was awfully tired, but I got a lot of rest, and I was determined to be here today if I had to arrive on a gurney. So, anyway, I missed you guys. I appreciate your prayers so much. And I love our church family. And I didn't even have to wonder about it or think about it. I knew you were praying for me. And I appreciate it so much. A couple of things coming up in the near future. Of course, tomorrow is Christmas.
Amen.
And that's always exciting. And we're going to be spending Christmas with Sandy's brother in Riverside. And tonight we're spending, the family's getting together at Laura's house for Christmas Eve. And I'm hoping they're going to find a football game in there somewhere. Anyway, things coming up in the near future. On the first Tuesday, and I think the first Tuesday of January is the second, if I'm not. Does somebody have a calendar? It's the second in there. So on the second, we have the ladies' luncheon over at Hillcrest. So I hope you ladies will plan on coming, and it'll be a lot of fun. And we'll keep you posted on other things coming up. And praise God. All his little guys are here today. So, and be in prayer for Sandy. She woke up yesterday morning throwing up and sicker than a dog. And she was sick all day, and I told her, I said, babe, just stay home tomorrow because you don't need this. So she's at home resting and getting well. So pray for her, please. Ushers? Yes, sir.
One more thing, DJ. In your absence, we met and exceeded our Lottie Christmas offering. We're at $1,110. So I just want to thank you, church.
Praise the Lord. You done good. That's great. That's great. Ushers, come on up. You know, I have always appreciated how this church responds to missions. You always do. And I'm proud of you for that. Let's pray. Who's praying today? Okay, Carlos. You're going to need to pull that microphone up a little bit.
That was a long time ago. There you go.
Oh, man, I've gone off from noise. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, once again, we give you all the praise and the glory and thanks for having our pastor here today, Lord God, and seeing over him, Lord God. And we just thank you for everyone here, Father, that are here to worship and to praise you, and that we remember what Christmas is, Lord God. It is the greatest gift, the one gift. And we just thank you, Lord God, for all the gift that you've given us, the ability to receive salvation through a Savior who was born long ago, Lord God. We thank you. And I pray for the offering, Lord God, both the giver and the gift, that you would bless both of them, Lord God. And as we go through Christmas, we know what Christmas really means. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Okay, ladies. Who's going to ring bells for us today, anybody?
Yeah.
Who's got them? All right. Do your job. We're ready, Dennis.
Everybody likes to take a holiday. Everybody likes to take a rest. Spending time together with the family. Sharing lots of love and happiness. Come on, ring those bells like the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King. Because of some.
excited to listen to you. God bless you guys for being here. Love you, brother. Yeah, you might need a mic. God bless you. Love you, brother. Christmas Eve or Christmas time, you don't have any choice what you're going to preach about. I mean, we need to preach Jesus no matter how well we know the story, no matter how familiar it is to us. We need to do that. So I'm going to start off with some things that Elijah said. Elijah, there were many great prophets. Elijah was one of them. Jeremiah was one. Daniel was one. Ezekiel was one. Elijah. Prophets that there was no doubt about the fact that they were prophets.
Amen.
Because of what they did and what they said and then when it came true. One of the interesting things about Isaiah is that he mentions the most specific things about Jesus coming again or being born. Jesus lived and wrote his book in two parts. And he wrote 700 years before Jesus was born.
Amen.
Generally, not many were aware or understood that this passage, because it was written for later. One of the interesting things about prophetic speakings, sometimes there is a wonderment about when these things will apply. And we find ourselves in that kind of situation somewhat today.
Amen.
We know that Jesus has come and risen. We know that he is in heaven. We know that Israel has been restored. And now we are waiting for other things to happen because prophecy has not become fulfillment yet. And so one of the interesting things, I'm taking the message today from that perspective. So for example, the verse that I'm focusing on in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 is, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and she will name him Emmanuel." Now, to the people of the day that heard these words spoken by Isaiah, they wondered, what in the world does that mean? You know, what? Because it went years and years and years before anything ever happened. So the verses that Isaiah is talking about was actually a response to a man named Ahaz, who was the son of the king of Israel. And in Isaiah chapter 7, it explains all of that. Notice this to be a sign actually to all generations. We have signs today. I mean, I'm following religiously the Israeli-Hamas war because I want to know every day what's going on. Because it is part of prophecy.
Amen.
And what happens in this war is going to affect the end of time and the coming of the Lord again. And so I'm very interested in that. We have signs of war, rumors of war, people failing in their faith, all over the news media, all over the internet, and the day-to-day more and more becomes a changed day because of the people losing their faith or losing interest. The sign of Israel, and no one being about to defeat them, the sign of the temple. I remember when I was attending college, the last college I attended, the college before I got my seminary degree, was University of California, Fullerton. That's where I graduated. And they had a rabbi there, Rabbi Clear, who taught Old Testament. Because he knew Hebrew, and his daughter also taught at the college, and she knew Hebrew. So they had Hebrew classes, they had Old Testament, all stuff that you wouldn't get ordinarily anywhere else. I took every class that I could get from them. One day, I made a big mistake. He was asking for questions. We'd just been talking about the temple and its destruction and everything. And I raised my hand and I said, Professor, when will the temple be rebuilt? And I thought that guy was going to come out of his shoes. He said, the temple's not going to be rebuilt. We're not going to have anything to do. I mean, he went off. And I thought, oh, I'm sorry I brought that up. And I was really embarrassed. But today, all the talk is about when the temple is going to be rebuilt. The word today, unofficially, is that the temple is already built. And it's prefab. And all the blocks of granite are numbered and ready to fit together on whatever day the Lord opens the door.
Amen.
So we see things from a different perspective about Jesus and about the coming of the Lord and about the millennium and about eternity much clearer than people did 50 years ago. And so I'm excited about that. So as a result of this passage of Scripture, the prophecy, here is the reality found in Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Now the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the descendants of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And coming in, he said to her, greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was very perplexed at this statement and was pondering what kind of greeting this was. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and give birth to a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end. But Mary said to the angel, how can this be, since I am a virgin? The angel answered and said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. For that reason, also the Holy Child will be called the Son of God. So there, in that perspective from the Gospel of Luke, what Isaiah said so long ago literally came true and was verified. The sign that took place in Mary, as the angel explained to her, God speaking to our heart, or an angel, is an awesome thing to happen. I've always wondered what it would be like to have an angel come to speak to me. Can you imagine it? I mean, it would be overwhelming. In fact, every time an angel has come and spoke to somebody that we have record of in the Bible, they have fallen to the ground with their face on the floor. And angels are holy. And when they come and when they say something, it's directly from God. Because angels basically are messengers from God. Now I'm going to come to another passage of Scripture that is Old Testament prophecy. In Isaiah chapter 9, for a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. This is an interesting description of Jesus and names for Jesus. This is more descriptive and will probably not meld in the current day that we live in today. In many circles today, Jesus is just the name of Jesus, and his story is just tolerated. And many other places, it's not tolerated at all. Christians that are found in Muslim worlds very often are stoned or put to death. So Jesus is not a popular name everywhere. But not only is he to be ruler, but beloved and powerful and eternal and royalty. Jesus had all of the symptomatics, descriptions of God, because he is God. I am the great I am, as Daniel just sang about. So with that on our mind from the perspective of the prophecy given in Isaiah, it says in Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 8, in the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly drew near them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terribly frightened. And so the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, there has been born to you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly army of angels, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on peace, on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. When the angel had departed, they then went back to heaven. The shepherds began saying to one another, let's go straight to Bethlehem then and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. And they came in a hurry and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in a manger. When they had seen him, they made known the statement which had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed about the things that were told them by the shepherds. But Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds went back, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, just as they had been foretold. The sign of God, the sign from God was finality and became a living thing to us. For the days around Mary and for us to believe. Christmas is an interesting celebration day. I listened to a lot of sermons online. My favorite people to listen to is Charles Stanley. I like Greg Laurie, Chuck Smith, who has passed away. I think Charles Stanley has passed away too. And if I'm really ambitious, I'll listen to J. Vernon McGee, who has passed away. But I also like to listen to Billy Graham, who has passed away. But their messages are still clear and concise to us today. Billy Graham was saying he had been on a traveling thing, and he had been to some big cities in the United States, New York, Baltimore, Chicago, and so on. And he said everywhere he went, it was Christmas time. There were lights and laughter and all kinds of celebration, but never any talk about Jesus. Because Christmas has taken on a secular celebration that has a whole new perspective and theme. It's giving and receiving presents. It's things like snow and a jolly old elf and a bunch of little elves. And all the story goes on about where Santa lives. Even though his name is really Saint Nick, patterned after a saint in Europe, it makes no difference. Christmas, as we generally know it on the street, is not about Jesus. But when we back up and we look at it from what we know and what we believe, we realize that Jesus is the reason for Christmas because it's his birthday. And so we as Christians celebrate Christmas as celebrating the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now the interesting thing about Jesus is he didn't come to just be born. But that was amazing in itself.
Amen.
The fact that he was born and that he grew up and that he did the things he did. And amazing. Which verified over and over again that he did come from God and he was the Son of God and he is the Lord. And all of the things that we've come to believe and understand and know. But you know what Jesus really came for? He came to die. When he was sent to earth, when he came to earth on our behalf, he knew that he was coming to die. Because the Old Testament tells us there must be shed blood for sin. And so, if you've read very much of the Old Testament, you will hear about a lot of burnt offerings that were made. Most of all in front of the tabernacle and in front of the temple. And they were usually on celebrations of God forgiving sin and God doing this, getting a good crop, and God doing that. But we knew from the study of Old Testament that a lamb had to be sacrificed after it had been cut and bled out and burnt on an altar as a symbol for what Jesus was going to eventually come and do. You recall not long ago in the first chapter of John, I was preaching and about how when John the Baptist saw Jesus coming, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." The Lamb of God. God sent his Lamb to die and shed blood for us so that all the generations that receive him and people who proclaim him will be saved. So while we celebrate Christmas, and Christmas is about life to us, the birth of Jesus, the celebration of our life and what God has done for us in our soul in so many different ways, didn't really come to fruition until he died on the cross.
Amen.
And then all of the believers were able to look back and realize the reason he came and the reason he was sent was to die. But it goes beyond that. Every lamb that had been sacrificed, every bull, every animal that had been sacrificed in front of the temple, in front of the tabernacle, at Abraham's house, out in the field, out in the desert, was all for forgiveness of sin. And it talked about death for sin. But Jesus' sacrifice, as you know, does not end there. Because on the third day, he rose from the dead. Because he is the Son of God, he is the Lord Almighty, and you can't take his life from him. But what he did was he portrayed in this event that we are born, we live, we make choices about our lives, and if we choose Jesus, we'll never die. Now, I heard another sermon about death and about the death of non-believers. You know, the truth is that everybody lives forever.
Amen.
A lot of people think, well, only Christians die and live forever. No. Everybody lives forever. It depends on where you spend eternity. And Jesus is all about us spending eternity with him because of our faith and because of our choices and because receiving the grace of our Lord. So, when you look at it from that way, it's a very complicated story, a long story. But tomorrow we celebrate that part of it where Jesus is born. And what a blessed day it is. The hope of God is that these people that are shopping from place to place, one of the interesting things, most of those movies we've watched on TV show all of these big stores like Bloomington's, or is it Bloomingfield's or what? Bloomington. All the big stores in New York that mostly don't even exist anymore, but we have some of those out here like May Company and now there's Macy's, and most of us don't shop in places like that except from time to time. Shop at Kmart. Oh, no, Kmart's gone, isn't it? See, I'm not up with it all the way. We shop at Walmart. We shop at Target. Sometimes we shop at the drugstore. And things have changed over the years, but we're still caught up in this idea of giving and receiving gifts, and there's nothing wrong with that. Christmas is a celebration for us to celebrate. But keep in mind, the real celebration is that it's a birthday party for Jesus, and that he is to be foremost in our thoughts. I hope that as you celebrate tomorrow, you'll remember that that will be the birthday of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that will be one of the cool things that I see. In my neighborhood, there are a lot of Christians. And they have signs out like that say, "Happy Birthday, Jesus." And like, "Jesus is the reason for the season," and things like that, that speak of Jesus. And that's the one thing I think is important for us to remember on Christmas, is to remember to speak of Jesus. It's his birthday. And Saint Nick, Santa Claus, is just so much fluff. And Christmas is a wonderful time for all of us. And Jesus is the reason for the season. So I hope that tomorrow you're able to celebrate with friends or family. I can think back on some Christmases that were just my own family by ourselves. That happens sometimes. We was pastoring a church that was so far away that we didn't have any family to go to. And that happens from time to time. But it was always joyful because Jesus was in the celebration. And it was a wonderful thing. Now, we're going to close this service today. And I believe that we are singing Silent Night. And if you are able, I'd like for all of you who can to come up here to the front, and we're going to sing Silent Night up here together as the choir of God celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. If you can come up, that's fine. Stay where you are and just join us there, okay? So let's come. And Lori, she's already at her keyboard. Dennis, I'm going to ask you to dismiss us in prayer, please.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just come before your throne of grace on this special day, Christmas Eve 2023. And Lord, we just pray that the impact of your Son will weigh on each and every one of our hearts, souls, and minds. And Lord, as we lift him up this Christmas season, we praise you, give you all the honor and the glory, in the name and the power of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Merry Christmas to each one of you.